I want to thank you for giving me the opportunity to come and to speak to what is still a familiar crowd, and we appreciate the chance to come visit with y'all once again. When I originally saw the list of who was going to be speaking in your lectureship this week, I thought, boy, that's a pretty good list. You got real preachers. Except for that guy on Wednesday night. He's kind of an amateur. So I will do my best. And it was the question was asked, did I like having a topic assigned or choosing my own? And the truth of the matter is, it's great to have a topic. The problem is that the topic I was assigned is one of the key themes, I believe, of the Bible and the nature of God. And so we will limit our discussion this evening to 3 or 4 hours at the most on the subject of holiness. I hope you're being, understand I'm not being serious. But the idea of holiness is something that is, I'm convinced, foreign in our time today. The idea of something being holy is more or less lost, if you will, on our society. We don't think in terms, and I say we as an Americans living here, don't typically think in terms of something being holy. It's not a word that we use, or the idea of holiness, the nature of being holy. We don't use that word, that concept, very often in our daily lives. But it is, as I said before, it is one of the central themes, I'm convinced, of the Bible. It's one of the key parts of God's character. And most importantly for us, it is one of the things that God expects of His creation and His children. Is the idea that we set aside certain things to be holy, our own lives to be holy. And so, if you would, I'd like to spend some time looking this evening at 3 questions to address this topic. And those 3 questions are, first of all, what is holiness? And why is holiness important to God? And then how do we get more of it? So, like I said before, we don't really use holy or holiness in a common way today. And so we want to try to define what exactly we're talking about when we say the word holy or holiness. What are we discussing? Vines uses the definition, separation to God, sanctification, the resultant state, the conduct befitting those who are so separated. Look with me, if you would, in 2 Corinthians chapter 6. We'll begin our study a few verses before chapter 7 and verse 1. We're going to look at the context to address the first 2 questions, and then we'll answer the last question, how do we get more holiness, by looking at chapter 7 and verse 1, our key passage, if you will, for the evening. The world, if you will, is described somewhat in this in a set of comparisons in chapter 6, beginning in verse 14. This is 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and in verse 14. It says, "Do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers, for what partnership has righteousness with lawlessness, or what fellowship has light with darkness? What accord has Christ with Belial, and what portion does a believer share with an unbeliever? What agreement has the temple of God with idols?" If you look at those descriptors, if you will, of the world in that list, we see the lawless, the darkness, Belial. We'll talk about that in just a second. Unbelieving and idolatry, or those who are unbelievers and idolatry. It's not too difficult to look at this list of things and the comparison that's made and to see that the world is full of those things. That there is plenty of lawlessness in the world. We've seen even today, haven't we, an attack in London where people disregarded the law, not only the law of the land in not committing murder, but just the law of God in treating life as something that is precious. That's just one example. And that comes from a place of darkness, a place of wickedness in that person's heart to perpetrate that. Belial is a Hebrew word that means worthless or man of worthlessness. In the Intertestament period, it became attributed to, or a kind of a proper name, for Satan himself, the ruler of this age, the ruler of this world, the unbelieving. It's interesting to me to notice that it seems like the world we live in seems to be going further and further away from any kind of belief in God at all. Not only an adherence to the Bible as it is written in God's actual expectations, but just the idea of respect for the Creator in any way. It's a common theme and seems to be growing more common. I don't say that to be alarmist or anything like that. But unbelieving in idolatry, Now, most of us probably don't see the kind of idols that we think of every day, right? We don't see some graven image, some golden calf or something that people sacrifice animals to or what have you. We think of that as idols. But people have their idols today. It's still common. It's still something that exists today in the minds of mankind. And what's interesting, you go back and look at Romans chapter 1, it didn't take very long before idolatry became an issue. From the very beginnings of man, if you will, it was a problem. The idea of worshiping and serving the creature, or things made by the creature rather than the Creator. Idolatry exists today. People love money. That's probably the biggest idol that we have in our nation, in our time. Some people have idolatry that political considerations or political philosophies that go into the realm of idolatry in their belief system. That's the world. But what is the Christian to be? The Christian is to be separated from those things. And that's really fundamentally what holiness is. In this particular context, the idea is that the Christian is to be segregated from those things. Those are the things that are distinctly discussed here, and I think some of the words are interesting the way that they are described. First of all, what partnership, and I'm reading from the English Standard Version, what partnership has righteousness with lawlessness? What partnership does it have? How can you have somebody who claims to love God's law, respect the laws of the land that are put in place by those who God has put on this earth to keep order? How is it that we can say we love God's law and we want to abide by God's law and even the laws of man, and yet we're going to have partners, we're going to try to work in the same system, if you will, with those who do not regard it? Darkness and light. Can you have darkness and light in the same place at the same time? What fellowship, I love that word, what fellowship has light with darkness? If you and I, and this is one sense of the word fellowship, but if you and I sit down and we eat dinner together, we're enjoying a type of fellowship there. We're able to sit at that same table. Can light and dark do the same thing? No, where light is, darkness doesn't exist, and where darkness is, light cannot exist, does not exist. That's by its definition. And notice here the idea that what accord has Christ with Belial? On what things do they agree and work together? Where do you see Christ and Satan working together to achieve a common goal? An accord, if you will. Where have they agreed that this is what we're going to do together to achieve this? No, they are diametrically opposed because of their nature. They're diametrically opposed because they both want us to do totally different things. They have totally different goals for humanity. And yet we see that word, it's obvious that it can't go together. What portion does a believer share with an unbeliever? What portion do we have? If we're all getting the same thing, what difference does it make? We're both trying to get two different things. We can't share in our efforts to please God with unbelievers. Now, certainly we can try to convince them to be believers and to join us in belief. What agreement has the temple of God with idols? The temple of God in ancient Jerusalem represented, if you will, the focal point for worship for the children of Israel in the Old Testament. It was, by definition, if you will, the place that God existed in the world, or existed in the sense of human minds being able to focus there and say, this is God's home, this is God's house. And the idea here is that there's no way that there can be an agreement for idols to join in with that. It was to be pure and holy in its construction and in its concept. And there's no way you could have both of those things there at the same time. And so we are, holiness is, in this context of 2 Corinthians chapter 6, is simply righteousness, light, following Christ, having belief, having faith, and worshiping, if you will, Him. And that's all I have. Thank you all very much. We've got two more questions to answer. So now that we have kind of an idea about holiness, why is it so important to God? Why is it that God cares so much about having things that are set apart to be just His? Set apart to be specifically for Him. Do you have things in your life that it's very important to you that it is set apart to be just yours? Anybody here share a toothbrush? No, it's important to you for a different reason, but it's important to you that it's set apart just for you. Maybe a pillow that you have, or your own bed. We always say that, right? We travel, we go do things, but it's nice to be home and to sleep in our own bed. It's important to us. So why is it that certain things, particularly in this context, the behavior and the character of His children, why is it that holiness is so important or so significant to God? Well, I think we can look back at the Old Testament and see a large portion of that. Turn with me, if you would, to Hebrews chapter 9. And we want to look very briefly there, Hebrews chapter 9. And we can look back at the Old Testament, and for the sake of time, and I always use that word for the sake of time, but in just a second we're going to see that the writer of Hebrews uses that same concept or same idea in just a second. But for the sake of time, we can't go back into the whole Old Testament and see how critical the idea of holiness, or something that's set apart specifically for service to or devoted to God. But if we look there at Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 1, now even the first covenant had regulations for worship and an earthly place of holiness, an earthly place that was set aside, if you will, for God. For a tent was prepared, the first section in which were the lampstand and the table and the bread and bread of the presence. It is called the holy place. Behind the second curtain was a second section called the most holy place. Having the golden altar of incense and the ark of the covenant covered on all sides with gold, in which was a golden urn holding the manna and Aaron's staff that budded, and the tablets of the covenant, above it were the cherubim of glory overshadowing the mercy seat. Of these things we cannot now speak in detail. So, not unlike the Hebrew writer, I can't go into detail about how in every case that holiness, or something being sanctified, that's the same word, the same concept, how important it was to God in the Old Testament. But it was. You'll remember that as God rested on the seventh day, we can go back to Genesis chapter 2, and we can see that He said that this day will be holy. The Sabbath day was instituted there. It was set aside just for a specific purposes. We see that sacrifices and worship, it talks about here all the specific details of how things were set aside and were specifically put aside for God and dedicated to God. Nadab and Abihu figured out what God meant when He wanted something His way, and He wanted it just for Him. What was the problem that they did? What did they do? They went and got something that was, some versions say common, some versions say profane fire. They went and got something, they got them a Zippo lighter and lit the fire instead of the fire that was prescribed. It wasn't holy. It had impurified their worship. The nation of Israel. In Leviticus chapter 19, look, turn over there if you would with me. We see that God had a place for worship we just saw there in Hebrews, and it was very specifically prescribed to be holy and to be set aside. But in Leviticus chapter 19, we're going to spend a little bit of time in Leviticus later as we go a little further. But I want to notice here a simple phrase that God makes. And He makes it several times in the Old Testament. But in Leviticus chapter 19, in verse 1, the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Speak to all the congregation of the people of Israel and say to them, 'You shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. Every one of you shall revere his mother and father, and you shall keep my Sabbaths. I am the Lord your God. Do not turn to idols or make for yourselves any gods of cast metal. I am the Lord your God.'" Verse 2 is where I want to focus there. He says, I want you to do these things. I don't want you going after anybody else. I don't want you devoting your time and splitting your time between me and some other idol. I want you devoted strictly to me and following my law, because you shall be holy, for I, the Lord, your God, am holy. God defines Himself in many different ways throughout the Scriptures, but in this particular context and elsewhere, we'll see in a minute, He defines Himself as holy. That is, He is set apart from the world around us. He is not part of everything that we do here on this earth. He's not involved in the sin and the corruption and the evil and the wickedness. He is above that. He is holy and set apart. And He expects those who say they follow Him, that are segregated to be His, He expects them to do the same thing. The whole nation of Israel itself was different from the people around it. He made very sure that they understood that they weren't to take up the customs and They weren't to start doing the things that the nations around them did. They weren't to intermarry with the people around them, because he knew that that would cause them to go away. It would lead them astray. He wanted them to be his own special people. We see the significance of separation and holiness in the Old Testament. It's one of those key themes. Well, truth of the matter is, God's character hasn't changed, and it's continued in the New Testament. Turn back to our main text there. That is, in fact, not 2 Corinthians chapter 5. That is 2 Corinthians chapter 6. It's funny how you can look over a PowerPoint 3 or 4 or 5 times and still miss something. So 2 Corinthians chapter 6. I apologize. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, we continue with our reading. And we're going to pick up there in verse 16 where we left off. For what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For we are the temple of the living God, as God said. Now let's look at these three phases, and they're quoted from the Old Testament. He says, I will make my dwelling among them and walk among them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. You notice that was a common idea where we just read Leviticus, wasn't it? I'm your God. You're my people. You're not Ashtoreth's people. You're not Baal's people. You're my people. And so we want to notice there that it is an acknowledgement, if you will. The idea of holiness is important to God because it is an acknowledgement of possession and ownership. It is an acknowledgement of possession and ownership. I will make my dwelling among them and walk among them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. I want you to think about for just a second. I kind of joked about it a little bit earlier, but you think about the things that are special to you, maybe from that you've inherited from somebody. Maybe it's a gun. Maybe it's a tool. Maybe it's a dish, or maybe it's something that you inherited from someone that you love that's passed on. And that thing has meaning to you because you associate it with, well, this was grandpa's pocket knife. And it has meaning associated to it. And when we segregate ourselves from the world, in the sense that we live our lives in a holy manner, we'll talk about that in a little bit more, but when we segregate ourselves and we seek holiness within ourselves, or for ourselves, I should say, we are acknowledging that God is in possession of us. We are special. We have a relationship of ownership and possession. God possesses me specifically. He doesn't share me. He doesn't have a timeshare. He doesn't get me on Monday, Wednesday, and Fridays, and I go somewhere else on Tuesdays and Thursdays. It is an acknowledgement of possession and ownership. He doesn't want divided allegiance. He doesn't want part of our love. He doesn't want part of our lives. He doesn't want part of our hearts. Just like he didn't want part of the children of Israel. And so we see that it is, in this context, I'll make my dwelling among them, walk among them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Secondly, we see that holiness is important because it is distinction from a sinful and fallen world. Let's keep reading there in verse 17. He says, therefore, go out from their midst and be separate from them, says the Lord, and touch no unclean thing, then I will welcome you. The idea of holiness to God is something that is not defiled by the world or the contents of the world that his special people live in. You know, if you go and you contaminate certain things, right? What happens over time? You put one, I'll use the old phrase, right? You put one rotten apple in a bushel. Well, over time it spreads and everything else. Well, it's the same way with Christians. It's the same way with God's creatures. He wants something that's not contaminated by all the bad stuff that we are around from day to day in a sinful and fallen world. We're going to look at another verse in Leviticus a little bit later on, and one of the things God makes the point about is that you're not supposed to be like the people around you. They've been wicked, and I'm going to punish them for being wicked. I'm going to drive them out because of their wickedness. He wants us to be special, and because he wants a distinction between what we are to him in his eyes and what the rest of the world is in its sinfulness. That doesn't mean he doesn't love the rest of the world. That doesn't mean that he doesn't desire for the sanctification and for the rest of the world to seek holiness and is able to find it. But the bottom line is, that's what he wants. He wants those who come to him to be separate and apart from the world and the influences, if you will, or the pollution, if you will, of the world that is around them. It's a distinction from a fallen world. I went into the kitchen the other day, and I'm trying to remember what kind of fruit. I think it was oranges. And opened up the drawer in the kitchen, and I wanted an orange. The first time I've eaten fruit probably in 10 years. I'm exaggerating. But I decided to get an orange, and I reached down in there, and lo and behold, that orange was in there. And I grabbed it. I said, that looks pretty good. And then I looked at the rest of them, and there was mold growing on the oranges. And I said, whoa, I think I'm going to put that back. A good husband would have cleaned it out. I just put it back. But I didn't want it. I looked at it and I said, no, that's not, I don't want that. Because they've been polluted by the things around it. When we approach God, when he looks at us, he doesn't want to pick up Ryan and say, oh, look, there's Ryan. He's just like all that other. He probably got some other damage. No, he wants us to be holy. He wants us to be distinct from a sinful and fallen world. In verse 18, as we continue reading there, 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 18, and I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters to me, says the Lord Almighty. It's a demonstration when we seek to be above the world that is around us. And we seek to be holy. We seek to be separated for a particular purpose, and that is serving and loving our Creator. It demonstrates that we value and we appreciate the relationship that we have with God. When we set aside certain parts of our lives, or we set aside certain things in just our everyday life, it means we value the relationship. Amy keeps a guest room at our house. It's full of Legos on the floor. You wouldn't like it right now. But she keeps that room neat and clean and fresh sheets and a little basket of toothpaste and little sundries or whatever that you might need if you come to our house. She does that. Those are set aside. I'm not allowed to use the stuff in that room. Okay? And she does that because she values the relationship that she has with people who come to our house and stay there. She looks at that, and it is important to her that those people feel comfortable, that those people feel welcome. She appreciates the value of that relationship, and so she keeps those things ready. She even got a little chalkboard thing that's got the Wi-Fi password on it because she values the relationship with those people. In much the same way, I will be a father to you, and you shall be sons and daughters to me. When I say to myself, self, I'm not going to be like the rest of the world. I want to be set apart, and I want to be away from the defiling influences of the world, and I want to think about God, and I want to serve God with a whole heart. I want to do all of those things. What I am doing and what God sees is that there is a soul who values its relationship with its Creator. And there is no greater relationship than to be sons and daughters of the Lord Almighty, as it's described there. There is value in that. When we are special, when we are set aside in our character, in our lives, in our souls, we are showing God that we care about Him enough and we want to please Him enough, and it is important enough to us that He see us as acceptable, that we're willing to forgo things we may really, 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 really want, or things we may have enjoyed doing in the past. And so holiness is so important to God because it is a demonstration of the value and the relationship that we place upon, of the value of the relationship that we have with God, that we place upon His worth and His value in our lives. So that's why holiness is so important to God. Well, then how do we get more of it? That's a good question. How do we get more holiness? This all sounds great. We're now, after a long introduction, going to actually answer or address the main topic for the evening. How do we get more holiness? Well, the reality is that man's been trying to come up with different ways. Some people may think, well, it's going to be by accident. And you know, God will accept us and I'm going to live right. It's just going to be by accident. And you know that's not true. It's not by force. Nobody is going to come in and put a gun to our heads and say, you will be holy for God. It doesn't work that way. It's something, it's a decision that we make. It's not by birth. Now you could say it is by the second birth, rebirth, or to be born again. But we're not born into it. It's not, has nothing to do with what color your skin is or what genes you have or who your parents were or who your great-great-great-grandparents were or what part of the world you're from. It's not something that you inherit by birth. Holiness isn't done by vain rituals. You don't get to have some kind of cool vain ritual. You say some special words and you wave a magic wand or whatever it may be. That's not how we are sanctified. That's not how we are set apart for God's purpose. Continuing on, it's not by rationalization. And what I mean by that is, it's not that I can be more holy in the eyes of God by coming up and rationalizing my behavior and saying, yeah, God would like that. God would like that. It doesn't work that way either. Not by comparison to others. Well, you know, I'm a pretty decent person. You know, these other people around here, I mean, look how horrible they are. I'm pretty good. That's not the way that we get more holiness, by looking around at other people and saying, well, at least I'm better than them. Or I go to church regularly. I'm there every time the door is open. And a lot of people aren't. Not by time. The things that make us unholy, the sins that make us unholy, the thoughts, the actions, the omissions of things we should do, they don't go away with time to make us holy. We don't simply outlive the unholiness that's brought on by our sins. And we may not talk about this, may not think of it in this way, but it's true. We think about, we don't put it in these words so often, but we tend to, okay, I've sinned, and that sin is further and further every day. It's further and further on in my past. Really haven't addressed it. I really haven't asked God for forgiveness, but it's further back in my past. It's not by time, the passage of time, not by physical isolation. Paul addresses that with the Corinthian brethren when he talks about the fact that they don't need to come out of the world in Corinth. They don't need to physically quit dealing on a regular basis with the people of the world just in their daily lives. They don't need to start a colony somewhere. And there are communities, religious communities, that have tried this with physical isolation. And, you know, Mennonites or the Amish or whatever the case may be, they try perhaps to be holy and to be set apart. And in their minds, the answer to that is, well, we're going to physically just minimize the contact we have with the people in the world. It's not how it works. It's not by osmosis. It's a bigger word than I really know how to use, but it's not going to just magically happen. I forget why we were talking about it in a biology class when I was in college, and we talked about osmosis, you know, where things pass through a membrane. A salt usually passes through from higher salinity to lower salinity through a membrane or something like that. But obviously, I didn't pay too close attention, right? But we talked about that, and I remember our professor kind of joking that that's not how you get knowledge from your textbook. You don't just stick your forehead on it and let that knowledge come through there. It doesn't work that way. Same way with holiness. Holiness doesn't come by just having a Bible or having a thing that you hold or whatever that, or even just thinking good thoughts and it just magically comes into your character, into your soul, into your spirit. It's not by osmosis. There's no magic talisman that we hold that does that. But by taking advantage of the grace that's offered to us. You see, the reality is, very simply, that we cannot be holy on our own. But it's something that's extended. It's a two-part, if you will, process. Look with me, if you would, in Leviticus chapter 20. I want to go over there very briefly, and beginning in verse 22. And I want to see if I can demonstrate this from the Old Testament passage here in Leviticus chapter 20. And we begin reading there in verse 22. It says, "You shall therefore keep my statutes and my rules and do them, that the land where I am bringing to you to live may not vomit you out. And you shall not walk in the customs of the nation that I am driving out before you, for they did all these things, and therefore I detested them. But I have said to you, you shall inherit their land. I will give it to you to possess, a land flowing with milk and honey. I am the Lord your God who has separated you from the peoples. You shall therefore separate the clean beast from the unclean, the unclean bird from the clean. You shall not make yourselves detestable by beast or by bird or anything which the ground crawls, which I have set apart for you to hold unclean. You shall be holy to me, for I am the Lord. For I, the Lord, am holy and have separated you from the peoples that you should be mine." And I want you to notice, oh, we have one of those. Got a laser. I'm easily distracted. I'm sorry. I want you to notice who's doing, in the yellow highlight here, who's doing something here? Let's see. He says, "I'm bringing." Remember we mentioned that a little bit earlier. He says that the customs of those other nations, I detested them for the way that they were behaving. So I'm kicking them out and I'm putting you in there. He says, "I'm driving them out before you. I said to you, you should do this. I will give to you it to possess. I am the Lord your God. I have set apart. I, the Lord, am holy and have separated you." Notice that there is God who plays a critical, in fact, I would argue, the most critical role in our holiness. And if we think about it in terms of the New Testament, it's God offering His Son. He's told us that, that He saw that and realized that there's no way that we could be right. Once we've sinned, there's no answer to that sin. There's no way for that sin to be washed away and for us to be holy and uncorruptible in His sight anymore, except by the death of His Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And in the same way, I want you to notice here, that's only part of this. The other part of holiness is derived from what we do in response to the grace that God has offered. I'm going to ask you a question. You don't have to raise your hand or shout it out or anything, but did the children of Israel earn or do what they needed to do on their own without the help of God? Did they earn and themselves work out a way to have the promised land? They do it by themselves? Did they go hire an army and go handle it themselves? No. They relied upon God's offering to them, and they took advantage of it. Much in the same way God expected that. He says, "You, therefore, shall keep all my statutes, all my rules, and do them. And you shall not walk in the customs. I'm giving you a chance. Here's the door. It's open to you. Question is, what are you going to do with it?" Says, "You shall inherit the land." You're going to have to go up there and get it. Remember, they struggled with that, didn't they? They struggled just with going out and doing it. The spies went into Canaan. Everybody but Caleb and Joshua came back and said, "Oh, ho, ho, this ain't going to work." They struggled even from that point. He says, "You shall go and inherit it. I will give it to you. You shall therefore do these things. Separate the clean beast from the unclean, and the unclean bird from the clean. You shall not make yourselves detestable by beasts. You shall be holy to me." You are going to have to read what I told you to do and make up your mind whether or not you're going to do it. If you're going to be holy, if you're going to be my holy people, if you're going to do that, if you're going to have that, you're going to have to contribute to it. You're going to have to hold up your end of the bargain, if you will. And so we go back to 2 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 1. In the same way in the New Testament, 2 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 1, we have finally made it out of the introduction to the lesson. Because we have these promises, or your version may say, since we have these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from every defilement of body and spirit, bringing holiness to completion in the fear of God. The English Standard Version is a little bit different from what you may be reading. The idea of perfection may be, or making holiness perfect. But the English Standard Version, I think, to me, it's clear in my mind. When it says that I'm bringing holiness to completion, I'm getting to the point at which I finally segregated myself, I finally got myself away from the pollutions of the world, and I'm finally set apart then for God's use and His purpose. Because we have these, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves. I put this in green here. Let us cleanse ourselves. It's incumbent on us. You see, God in the very beginning created man and woman, put them in the garden, gave them everything they physically needed, did His part. But then He gave them one more thing, and that was free will to choose. I know He gave them free will because He told them not to do something. If they didn't have free will, if they were just flat driven by their desires and had no way to control it, He wouldn't have had to tell them anything. But He gave them a choice, and He said, you can either not eat of this forever, or you can eat of this tree and you surely will die. He gave them a choice. And He's given each one of us, He has created each one of us with the ability to choose. And so we have the ability to choose if we want to be perfect in our holiness, if we want to complete the goal of being holy because we value the relationship we have with God enough, because we want to be identified as owned by Him and a possession of Him, because we want to be distinct from the world around us. If we want to do that, we have to make the decision, let us cleanse ourselves. We have to make that decision. But the question is, and okay, that's great. How do we do it? How do we do that? Well, we cleanse the Spirit. Turn with me, if you would, to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. We're going to look at the couple of letters to the Thessalonian brethren where Paul addresses these ideas, I think, in more detail. And we're not going to dive for the sake of time into a terrible amount of detail here, but I just want to look for a few more minutes at these. The idea of cleansing the Spirit. What are the things that make our spirit, our mind, our heart, what are the things that make that, we see there, from every defilement of body and spirit? And I put spirit first because the spirit drives the body's behavior. So it's intentionally out of order, if you will. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, and beginning in verse 13, I want you to notice with me where Paul writes to the Thessalonian brethren. He says, it ought always to give thanks to God for you, brothers, beloved by the Lord, because God chose you as the first fruits to be saved through sanctification by the Spirit and belief in the truth. That word sanctification in the English Standard Version there, you see that sanctification by the Spirit, capital S, the Holy Spirit, if you will, and belief in the truth. You see, that Spirit isn't sanctified because I just sit there and try to figure it out. No. The Holy Spirit has given me knowledge, or it's given me words that I can read and people to teach me that I can know what I need to do, and so I can do those things. And not only can I know them, but I can believe them, at the end of verse 13. To this He called you through our gospel, so that you may obtain the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Notice the tool that was used. To this He called you through our gospel. This is Paul writing. Through this good news, this message of Jesus Christ, that I've given you, that you've heard from me. That's the tool. The words that we've given you, that was the tool so that you may obtain the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 15, so then, brothers, stand firm and hold to the traditions that you were taught by us, either by our spoken word or by our letter. You and I don't have the spoken word of Paul, and we don't have the spoken word of Christ today with us. or any of those inspired writers in the New Testament. We don't have their spoken words. I can't go up to Paul and say, hey, what did you mean here? That would be really, really neat, wouldn't it? But what I do have is exactly what he directs them to. He says, or by our letter there in verse 15. You see, our spirit is cleansed by looking at the words that God has given us. And seeing then that, okay, this is what God wants me to do. This is how he wants me to be. That's how I can take advantage. That's how I may obtain the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 16. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and gave us eternal comfort and good hope through grace, comfort your hearts and establish them in every good work and words. I want you to think about that for just a minute. If you're sitting there with a Bible in your lap this evening, or I've got mine up here on the little podium thing here, I want you to think about what God did to get that to you today. We went to Barnes & Noble before we came over here, and there's a whole rack over there in different languages and different colored covers and all kinds of neat stuff, different formats, all kinds of Bibles. Do you realize that the words contained in those and the words contained in the book that's sitting in front of you were passed down from the very mind of God through inspired men who spoke as God inspired them, who wrote it down, has been passed down through millennia to you and me today so that we can know what God wants us to think about and what he wants us to focus on so that we can be acceptable to him and show him that we love him? It's a very amazing thing. How many other thousand-year-old books did you read today or pick up or have in your house? It's something God has done for us, has provided for us. We still have the very words of Paul as he wrote to those Corinthian brethren. Or excuse me, Thessalonian brethren. Yeah, to the Corinthians as well. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. Comforting your hearts, verse 17, he says, and this is 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. We'll get to the other passage in a second. But he says, comfort your hearts and establish them in every good work and word. You see, we don't just take and we don't just have a mental assent to God, and that's what determines holiness. We don't just sit there and we don't just kind of think our way, if you will, to holiness. Holiness is developed when we change our mind. Our mind is cleansed from the pollutions of the world. Our mind is changed from the way we used to think about things. And then we start to put it into action in our bodies. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3 and verse 11. Paul writing to the same folks a little bit earlier. He says now in verse 11, now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus direct our way to you, and may the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for us as we do for you, so that he may establish your hearts blameless and in holiness before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus with all the saints. So Paul is praying for an opportunity to go be with the Thessalonian brethren so that he can do exactly what we just talked, so he can help their hearts get better. So through his instruction, as divinely inspired by the Word of God, and not only just his divine instruction, but just his love, his concern, and his efforts towards them, so that their hearts can be sanctified. And so that they can then be blameless in holiness. That's what he's asking for. Chapter 4, verse 1. Finally then, brothers, we ask and urge you in the Lord Jesus that as you receive from us how you ought to walk and to please God just as you are doing, that you do so more and more. For you know what instructions we gave you through the Lord Jesus. For this is the will of God, your sanctification. There's that word again. Set apart. That you abstain from sexual immorality, that each one of you know how to control his own body in holiness and honor, not in the passion of lust like the Gentiles who do not know God. So I want to look at that for just a second, and I want to notice here that it all starts with where your heart is. Your heart's what drives your behavior. It's what drives your body to do what it does. And he says, I'm hoping I get an opportunity. I'm praying for an opportunity to come to you so that I can strengthen, so your hearts can be better. And then he talks about how you need to take those instructions that you've already gotten, verse 2, and put them into practice and use them. For this is the will of God, you're saying that you abstain from sexual immorality. I don't know what the Thessalonian brethren had as a specific set of problems, but I'm going to be, I believe, fairly safe in assuming that sexual immorality or sexual temptation was just as big a problem for them as it is for us today. And he says you're going to have to apply the things, the concepts that came from God, and you're going to have to put those into work in disciplining your body. That's how you're going to get to holiness. That's how you're going to be above the defilements of the world. Changing your heart, changing your mind, cleansing your spirit, and then putting that to work in your body. Therefore, let no one, verse 6, transgress and wrong his brother in this matter, because the Lord is an avenger in all these things, as we told you beforehand and solemnly warned you. For God has not called us to called us for impurity, but in holiness. Therefore, whoever disregards this, disregards not man, but God, who gives his Holy Spirit to you. The words that had been given to them through Paul and other inspired men that we have today. So I want you to know, sir, it's kind of interesting. Verse 7, God has not called us for impurity, but in holiness. God did not call you. He did not deliver this message so that you could have some kind of a conversion experience or kind of know what you need to do and have a thought at one point and then go back and just be like the rest of the world. He didn't pick you up out of the fruit drawer, pick you up and see, oh, here's some mold on here and brush it off and open up and make use of you just so that he could do all that, get you ready to use him and then throw you back in the rest of the world so it can continue to be polluted. He called us to holiness. It's what he wants. And when we disregard that, we're not disregarding man. Look, I've been disappointed by people in this life when they've gone back and done something that they said they wouldn't do again. I've been disappointed in me when I've gone and done something I said I was never going to do again. But disappointing us isn't the big problem. Disappointing people, that's not something we should strive not to do. But when we let those pollutions back into our minds and then we let our bodies follow along and we participate in those things, when we start looking at sexual immorality like the world looks at it, when we start looking at how we treat marriage and divorce and remarriage like the world looks at it, when we start talking like the world talks, when we let those things back into our hearts and into our bodies and into our practice and into our character, we're not disappointing other people. We might be. We're disappointing God, and that leads us to our last point. In the fear of God. Turn with me finally this evening to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. And beginning there in verse 17, we're not going to read the whole thing. But I'd like for you to look at the life that he describes of those who are not trying to serve God. They're darkened in their understanding. They've become callous. Verse 19, give themselves up to sensuality. All these things. He asked them to put themselves off of those things. Don't give opportunity, verse 27, to the devil. Don't steal anymore. Change your life, labor. Change the way you talk, verse 29. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you. Don't do that anymore. Be imitators of God. Verse 3. Sexual immorality is addressed, chapter 5, verse 3. No filthiness, foolish talk, crude joking, verse 4. All of those things that the world loves to do, don't let that be a part of you. Verse 6. Let no one deceive you with empty words. For because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not be partakers with them. You see, all of this is done in the fear of God. Holiness is not just a choice that we make to be holy or not, and there's no consequences for it. Ed Wise would disagree with me, but you can drive a Chevrolet or a Ford. There's no consequences for driving either one. Don't listen to Ed. But when you decide whether you're going to be holy in God's eyes, and you're going to strive to have your heart clean and your mind clean and your spirit clean and your body clean because you value and you love Him and you want to be one of His, when you make the decision to do that or not, you need to do it with fear. You need to do it with respect. And understanding that the decision you make has real, genuine consequences. So this evening, if you are living your life, maybe you obeyed the gospel many years ago. I know most people on Wednesday night are the local folks, if you will, the home crowd. If you've been living your life, you've obeyed the gospel, there was a time in which you were strong and you were sanctified. You were living a life of holiness and you've fallen away from that. And you need some help. You need the prayers of the congregation, the support, and whatever we can do to help you in that way, to come back so that holiness is then a part of your life. You understand the value that God places on it, and you want to be part of that this evening. We will help you in whatever way that we can. If you're not a child of God at this time, you're part of the world. You're part of the darkness. You're part of the wickedness. You're part of the pollution of sin. It's in your life. You can come out of that. You can become a child of God this evening. Put Him on in baptism. Take advantage of the grace that's been extended to you, and you can be holy this very hour. If we can help you with that, please let it be known as we stand and as we sing.